Morning, everybody. It's so good to come to church, to be with the Lord's people on the Lord's Day, to be strengthened, to be encouraged. I love it. We welcome you. We welcome our online audience. We're just glad to meet together. So today's message deals with the struggles that we face in our relationships. Every human that I have ever met has struggled in relationships. I think that's true. But I'm happy to tell you that our loving Heavenly Father offers us help so that we can have healthy relationships. The title of the message this morning is, Lord, Change Me. So I've got a lengthy question to ask us. At the end of the question, if your answer is yes to any part of the question, I want you to raise your hand. Now, don't be like first service. Just as soon as I started talking, they started raising their hands. I'll tell you when to raise your hand, okay? So here's the question. How many of us in this room have ever had an issue or a problem with another human being? You've had a run-in with somebody, an argument, a misunderstanding. You've either sent or received a strong email or text. You've either made or received a rough phone call. You've gone without speaking to someone, or someone has gone without speaking to you. Or there's someone in life that you just have trouble getting along with. If your answer is yes to any of that, raise your hand. Keep them up. Keep them up. Now, I want you to look around. I want you to look around. I think it's 100%. You can put them down. In first service, it was 100%. I think you're 100%. Some of the most godly people I know have relational conflicts. Two of the greatest men in Scripture, Paul and Barnabas, Scripture tells us had a sharp disagreement. They parted company for a while. They went their separate ways. They had a dust-up. Can I tell you this morning, Satan loves to be in relationships. He loves turmoil. He loves division, animosity, resentment. It's all a part of his plan of destruction. Beloved, there is a full-fledged battle raging to destroy us. Listen to Peter's comments about Satan. Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Satan is talked about in Scripture as a very real enemy because he is. He's a destroyer. He loves to destroy relationships. If you think about it, with one punch, Satan can affect two or more people. Revelation 12:10 calls our enemy an accuser. Satan will accuse your spouse to you. He will accuse your child to you. He will accuse your friend, your co-worker to you. And listen to this. He will whisper. He will whisper in your head. And when he whispers, he always puts a spin on it. He tries to get us to agree with him. It may go something like this. She doesn't like you. They hate you. You can't trust them. Did you know the grass is greener on the other side? Have you ever made an agreement with Satan? I have. Didn't mean to. A lot of times didn't even know I was doing it. But when we agree with Satan, we're already being defeated by our enemy. Beloved, relationships are under assault by the enemy. Listen to how Jesus described Satan in John 8. He described him this way. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. Beloved, listen. If you listen to a lie long enough, you'll believe it. Can I get a witness? That is the gospel truth. If you listen to a lie long enough, you'll believe it. That's who we're battling, and he wants to be right in the middle of our relationships. You see, he brings these accusations to us about someone else, and he wants us to agree with him. And when we do that, we literally backstab our own relationships. Beloved, this battle is much bigger than you may realize. You're in a battle whether you know it or not. But the question is, will you choose to fight? And if so, how will you fight? The enemy is not the person you're having conflict with. The enemy is not the person who lashed out at you. Your enemy is the one who's trying to destroy you and your relationships. Your enemy, my enemy, is Satan. He does not want you to find happiness and peace in God. He doesn't want you to have great relationships with others. He doesn't want you to be at peace with others. He only wants turmoil, hatred, and division. The forces of hell are against us. These forces are strong. But I have got some great news. We must realize the most powerful force in the universe is for us, God Almighty. The creator of the universe is for us. Hear what Paul said in Romans 8. If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things? God is for you and me. Now, I want to give you what may be a new way of thinking if you're having conflict with someone. Maybe it's a new way of thinking about life in general. Whatever struggle or conflict the Lord allows in your life, that struggle or conflict is a friend working for you, not against you. Think about that. Through the struggles and conflicts that we have and we go through in life, maybe, just maybe, God is trying to change us. If you and I serve Jesus Christ and want to bring honor to our Savior, the best thing we can ever do is bring Christ into our relationships. Jesus made another comment about Satan in John 10, verse 10. The thief, Jesus said, comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I'm convinced God wants us to have full, rich relationships. The most powerful force in the universe is for you. But we're in a battle. We are in a battle. The enemy is not the person you have conflict with. We know who the enemy is, but how will we fight? When we have a conflict with someone, we can spend time trying to understand it. We can try to analyze it. We can complain about it. We can tell others about it. And I've done all those. But I'm convinced the best way to fight a battle is down on our knees in prayer. When we do that, beloved, we go from fighting against someone to fighting for them. Do you see the difference? You go from battling someone to battling for them. God brings me so much peace when I pray for the person I'm having issues with, because when I pray for them, I always pray for me. I want you to try praying these two things going forward. Father, what are you trying to teach me here, right now, in this conflict? And Lord, change me. I'm convinced, based on Scripture, that the Lord is always trying to transform us and mature us and teach us. Lord, change me. What are you trying to teach me right now? You see, friends, when we understand these truths that I've already laid out for you, all of hell is out to destroy us. The most powerful force in the universe is for us. When we understand that we're in a battle and the best way to fight it is down on our knees, then I'm maintaining that Satan's influence becomes so much weaker. Every time I pray, I always feel better. I've learned I never look to any human being to fulfill me. I never look to any person to bring me peace or joy or happiness. When you come to that point, that takes so much pressure out of relationships. I look to Jesus to do that for me. Because once you figure out that the only peace and joy that can ever be found is in Christ, that takes so many obstacles and pitfalls out of relationships. Look to Christ. Now, real quick, I want to give us some things to beware of in our relationships. This is not an all-inclusive list, but I do feel it'll be helpful. In our relationships, beware of pressure, but accept responsibility. In relationships, pressure can kill everything it touches, especially in marriage. Pressure can come from anywhere. It can be internal. It can be external. A lot of times, these pressures are unspoken, but they're still there. As you know, life puts pressure on us, right? People put pressure on us. I want to introduce to you, or maybe reintroduce to you, one of the biggest, heaviest words in the English language. There it is. You know that word, don't you? Expectations. It carries so much weight. The expectations we put on other people. The expectations other people put on us. Beloved, expectations can kill relationships. They can be spoken. They can be unspoken. Nothing will bring pressure into a relationship like expectations. When we expect someone to do something for us that they simply cannot do or they should not do, like fulfill us or make us happy, or do something for us that we can do ourselves, all of us can bring expectations into a relationship, and therein lies a big part of the problem. It may go something like this. I expect you to read my mind and do something for me that you're totally unaware of. A lot of you are shaking your head. I'm disappointed that you failed to do something for me that you didn't even know I wanted you to do. Now I'm mad because you didn't read my mind and please me. Does that sound familiar? I will confess to you that my wife of 44 years has asked me many a time, "Do you think I can read your mind?" And we're still together. Beware of pressure and expectations. But accepting responsibility can mature us. That's true for all of life. Accepting responsibility is a good thing. If I have a relationship that's going poorly, what responsibility do I bear for that? We'll need the Lord for that one. Lord, show me my failures here. Show me how I've contributed to this failure. Lord, change me. Beware of pressure, but accept responsibility. Next one, beware of the internet. Anything with a screen on it can steal time from relationships. It can be a thief. Telephone, television, tablet, computer. They will steal time from relationships. But more than that, behind those screens can be temptations. We can be one click away from trouble or disaster. I can be one click away from disappointing people that really love me and disappointing my Heavenly Father. Beware of the internet. Right on the heels of that one, beware of addictions. Right. In thinking about the internet, pornography comes to mind. That stuff is total poison. It will warp your mind. It will wreck relationships. It will wreck a marriage. It will wreck a courtship. And there are other potential addictions. Alcohol comes to mind. Drugs come to mind, both the legal and the illegal. They can be addictive. Gambling comes to mind. Sports betting. I saw the other day that the new Caesars Casino is opening in Danville soon. A mammoth facility to aid you in your gambling desires. They can only build that facility because they take money, not because they give money. Just beware of that, okay? Beware of addictions. And I can make you two guarantees about addictions. Addictions will bring hard times into your life. Addictions will wreak havoc on your heart and the hearts of people that love you. Guaranteed. I can guarantee you that. Addictions only take, they never give. Now, these next two statements are statements that I've lived by, principles that I've lived by since I was a teenager. Beware of anything that can become an addiction to you. Beware of anything that can become an addiction to someone else if they see you doing it. Beware. Parents, grandparents, know this. You've got little eyes always watching you. Beware of addictions. Beware of debt and the love of money. Debt can bring pressure into your life. Debt can affect your ability to help people. Debt affects your ability to give. Debt can steal your joy. Debt has never been my friend. Never, ever. And I've been in debt many a time. Debt can handcuff you and strap you down. Debt can ruin a marriage. I'm not saying you shouldn't borrow money. I'm not saying that. I am saying be careful. We do well to have a biblical view of debt and money. Proverbs 22:7. The rich rule over the poor, and the borrower is slave to the lender. Debt can make you a slave. Paul told Timothy, for the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. Some people, eager for money, have wandered from the faith and pierced themselves with many griefs. Friends, an improper view of money can affect our walk with Christ. It can be easy for someone who loves money to have fractured relationships. Based on my observations, if a person loves money, they will usually put money before relationships. Regarding debt and money, I live by this statement. When your outgo exceeds your income, your upkeep becomes your downfall. I don't see how anybody could disagree with that. It's the truth. Beloved, you're going to love this last one. You're going to love this last one. Beware of the tongue. In our relationships, let's all beware of the tongue. Right? James, the half-brother of Jesus Christ, said this. And among all the parts of the body, the tongue is a flame of fire. It's a whole world of wickedness, corrupting your entire body. It can set your whole life on fire, for it is set on fire by hell itself. People can tame all types of animals, birds, reptiles, and fish, But no one can tame the tongue. It is restless and evil, full of deadly poison. Beloved, this is so ironic, but this is true. The most dangerous weapon in any relationship is also the biggest asset. It's the truth. With my tongue, I can tear you down, or with my tongue, I can build you up. With my tongue, I can become a fountain that breathes life into you, or I can become a drain that sucks the life right out of you. You and I literally have the power of life and death in our tongues. Amen? Here's some great guidelines. Before we speak, before we write, before we hit the send button, we do well to look at these questions. Is this the truth? Do I know that for sure? Is this fair to all concerned? Will this bring goodwill and better friendship? Will the words I'm about to say be beneficial to all concerned? And most importantly, will my words honor Christ? Wow. Aren't they beneficial questions to ask? Listen to what Peter said. This is powerful. 1 Peter 3, starting with verse 8. Finally, all of you should be of one mind. Sympathize with each other. Love each other as brothers and sisters. Be tenderhearted and keep a humble attitude. Don't repay evil for evil. Don't retaliate with insults when people insult you. Instead, pay them back with a blessing. That's what God has called you to do, and He will grant you His blessing. Now listen to this. For the Scriptures say, if you want to enjoy life and see many happy days, keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. Come on now. I want you to answer these questions audibly, okay? How many of you want to have great relationships? How many of you want to look more like Jesus? Okay? Here's some great advice. Never make a mountain out of a molehill. Now, I can't believe any of you have ever done that, but I have. I've taken a little bit of dirt from a molehill and tried to build a mountain out of it so I can have a hill to fight on and fight a battle that's not worth fighting. Don't make a mountain out of a molehill. And, beloved, give love and forgiveness in abundance. There's a lady that I've known for most of my life. She looks more like Jesus than anyone I've ever met. You can walk around this lady with a shovel and throw dirt all over her. You can fill up her shoes with dirt, cover her feet with dirt. You can pour dirt down her collar. You can cover her head with dirt. Then you can give the shovel a break and you can walk around her and spit on her. She will forgive you while the event is happening. And the next time she sees you, she will smile at you and treat you like nothing ever happened. She's the happiest, most joyous human I've ever met. It's because she offers love and forgiveness in abundance. I hope you catch this. Every time we choose to love and forgive, we take a step closer to God. But every time we choose something different, we take a step away. Love and forgiveness cost so much, and it's so hard. Just look at the cross. But friends, loving and forgiving is always worth it. Loving and forgiving people is our destiny. But all of hell is set against us. You see, Satan wants us to settle for so much less. Now, I can't speak for you, but in my relationships, I've concluded that I am my own worst enemy. The thing that gets in the way a lot of times is my way. I've got my own style of relating to people and getting along with people, my own way of doing life. I have my expectations, but maybe my way isn't the right way. And so I've asked myself, how did I get this way? How did I get in this mess? And I came up with three answers. The home I was raised in, my own sin and brokenness, and the influence of other people on my life for good and for bad. Does that make sense? That is what has formed my way of doing life. You see, in my relationships, I'd rather be right than wrong any day. I'd rather be first than last. I'd rather win the debate. I'd rather lead than follow anytime. And that's just the short version. But maybe my way isn't the right way. Maybe my way is what's getting in the way. I want you to consider this. Relationships can be a collision of our differences arranged by God for the purpose of transforming our character, for the purpose of transforming us. God wants to change you and me. Now, could you see any value in your transformation? I can see a lot in mine. Would you be willing to change your way if you thought you could have better relationships with other people? I'm willing. Know this, conflict will come, guaranteed. How will you handle it? How will you fight the battle? How much do you take to God right now? And are you fighting these battles on your knees? The greatest gift that you can ever give yourself, the greatest gift you can ever give the people that love you, is your relationship with Christ Jesus. Lord, change me. You see, friends, how things are in your spiritual life will affect every facet of your life. I guarantee you. All of hell is set against us. But the most powerful force in the universe is for us, God Almighty. It's so much easier to find peace and joy and happiness in life if your true joy and peace is found in Christ. I put some action steps at the bottom of the bulletin if you care to look at them. We need to find new life in Christ. Beloved, we need to know who we are in Jesus. That's essential. We need to deal with our own sin and brokenness, and as far as I can tell, that'll be a lifetime event for most of us. It will be for me. We need to learn to shut down the spiritual attacks that come against us. Robin and I were talking yesterday. These attacks seem to come daily. Those whispers, those little thoughts, they come daily. We've got to shut down the spiritual attacks. One of the best ways to do it is with Scripture. Philippians 2:5 will come close to summarizing this whole sermon. In your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Does anybody disagree with that? Have the same mindset as Christ Jesus. Lord, change me. Lord, change us. Would you pray with me?
Thank you for joining us today. If you feel like God spoke to you today and you would like to discuss your next right step with God, please visit cornerstonechatham.org, scroll to the bottom of the homepage, and fill out the form to connect with us. We hope you enjoyed being with us today, and we look forward to seeing how God is working around Cornerstone in person and online.